Hey folks, it's Frithgar here, how you doing? I have got the last of the silage down here. I have finished doing field one at long last. It took a long, long time. I finished doing it. I have returned the forager and I have just about finished rolling the clamp. And you can see up in the top right hand corner in our glance mod thing that we got up there, it's at 99% compaction and we have 1.4 million liters of chaff here in this clamp alone. That's it, right? There we go. It's 100% compaction. Oh, it's gone back to 99% now. There's a huge amount of silage. We've got an absolutely massive amount of silage on this run. Fantastic. So we'll be able to sell that. We'll get an absolute fortune for that. I just want to have a look here and see how much we'll actually get. What sort of price? I mean, at the moment it's 400 here and it's 500 here, and I'm just sort of been finding out recently in the time-lapse series that you can actually load it up into a lorry and you can take it off and we're here in America, it's a truck, not a lorry here in the States, and you can take it and you can load it up and you can sell it over at the barn for more money, which is absolutely fantastic. So it's something that we'll probably be doing. We're going to need to return the compaction stuff very shortly. I did say that I would just show you finishing up here, because we've done 2 weeks now of silage and you're probably fed up with it. We did some rolling of the clamp with a tank, which was a little bit different, and quite a few of you actually quite liked that. You really did quite like using the tank to do it. So we just come up here, we press R to blanket the silo, there we go. Right, so it's fermenting silage 1% so far. And we've got minus $40,000 at the moment. Well, 39,475, but you get the idea. Minus $40,000. We can go and borrow a load of money right now so that we can get our scorpion, because that is what we're all about now. We're going to be doing at least a week of forestry stuff, all forestry related at the moment. So we want to get that one there, $317,000 if we want to buy it. Or we can lease it for $25,000. Now, it is actually worth leasing that for $25,000. I have found that out previously, so we could just go and borrow the money and get that sorted. What I'm going to do right now, though, is I'm going to get these two trailers here. I'm going to get these back to our yard. I'll also get the voucher back to our yard, and I'll return all of those items. And then we want to get the Challenger planting the rest of the wheat back at the yard, the fields back by the yard. Before finally moving that one up to field one so we can start planting up there. We're not going to bother with the oilseed radish up on field one, I don't think. Well, actually, no, we might do. We might. I don't know. But anyway, I'm going to move a load of stuff around now that we've blanketed that one down, and I will see you in a minute. I've done a little bit of moving around. This field here has been finished. Oh, it's still lowered down. I don't know why it does that. Sometimes it does. I think it's when you exit the game, it puts it back in with it in the lowered position rather than in the up position. But yeah, that's minor detail. So I did have a few people asking me why I plant oilseed radish, new people to the channel. So the reason you plant oilseed radish is they act as a layer of fertilizer. So once we cultivate them back in, there'll be a layer of fertilizer. And because we plant them with fertilizer anyway, that's two layers of fertilizer done. And then you add more fertilizer here. It saves you having to go over the field with sprayers or fertilizer spreaders or manure or anything else. You just plant this, let it grow once, and then it goes again. Now, one thing that people have been telling me is that I shouldn't be planting this too often because it uses up one of the harvest things. You basically, when you plow the field, you can harvest three times before you need to plow again. And people have been telling me that the oilseed radish actually uses up one of those harvests. So if you use the oilseed radish, there's one harvest session done, and then you plant something else, there's another one. Plant oilseed radish again, suddenly your field needs ploughing. So you shouldn't do it too often. Now, I don't know about that. This is the first I've heard of this. I didn't realise that this was a thing. So, yeah, if anybody knows for certain, see, it seems at the moment that people are kind of guessing with it, and they're not 100% certain. So if anybody does know for certain what happens with the oilseed radish regards to ploughing, does it count as a harvest or not? I'd really love to hear about that. Anyway, my question I asked you all last week was, do you want me to do pigs on this map? Several people have said, look, for goodness sake, Frith, could you please stop doing pigs? It's been pig mad on the time lapse. It's been all about pigs on Sosnovka. Quite frankly, we're fed up with pigs. So I gave you the opportunity last week to say yay or nay to pigs on this map. And 2,901 people answered that question. And of your 2,900 people, 390 said, yes, we want pigs. And a resounding 2,500 people have said, no, absolutely not. We forbid it. We will not have pigs any longer. So 2,500 and, what did I say, 11 people have kindly requested that I don't do pigs on this map. We will just stick with cattle and sheep. So we'll get a few more of each, but we're not going to do pigs. So for those of you who wanted pigs, I'm very sorry. You've got pigs on the time lapse for a little while. And that's about it, actually, because we've just finished in Sosnovka. We're moving to Water Valley. There are no pigs there, so you won't have pigs on this one or in Water Valley. However, there will still be pigs on the time lapse, so you'll be able to see them on there. But we've done lots and lots of pigs, so no pigs. My main task for this week is forestry, like I've said, and I haven't done any forestry at all yet. I just need to go and clean these down here, the trailers and the truck, the Tatra. Once we've cleaned that, we'll let the Challenger... I'm pointing behind me, actually, right now. I'm actually physically pointing behind me. And I realise that you can't actually see that, so it's probably an exercise in futility. Let's clean this bad boy off a bit, because it's getting very, very grubby. I'm going to be doing some forestry. I want to get that Ponsse Scorpion. We're going to need to get our Goldhofer trailer and... use that to transport the Scorpion, where we're going to take it over to do the forestry. We also need to buy the placeable. Now, the problem with buying the placeable is we need to wait for that silage to be ready so that we can sell a load. Oop, I can't go any further. I'm going to have to go around this way. So we want to sell a load of silage and use that in order to get the money. But then we've sort of got to work on that as well. So we're going to need... we'll either need buckets or something with the Manitou that we've got, or we can get a load of conveyor belts and set the conveyor belts up. I'm actually running a mod at the moment, which is on the beta section in Mod Hub. And what you do is, so long as you've got silage going into the hopper, it doesn't change the price, like it used to work in FS15. Because at the moment, you actually get rewarded more for doing the conveyor belts than you do if you just use a bucket and spoon it in. And I'm kind of thinking it will do both. I won't spend a huge amount. I'll do it probably beginning of next episode, I think. We'll start doing a bit of selling of silage so that we can get a load of money so that we can get our placeable and get that one ready and done. Yeah, we'll do some cutting of trees, and then what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to sort of spend the night, I think, so that we've got plenty of silage. Now, I think that's fairly clean now. I came around this way, didn't I? I don't want to be wrapping it up in a knot. So let's just drop that one down there. One other thing I'd like to say is the colours on the map, the colours in these videos, might be slightly different to what you're used to. I had nearly a major catastrophe. I say nearly, it was a bit of a catastrophe. I had to reload a whole load of drivers and stuff like that. Fortunately, I didn't lose any important information. I do try to keep everything backed up anyway. But I had to reset the graphics. Basically, I had to reset the whole of the graphics card, and I had to reset all of my color profiles and everything. So I've tried to reset it because for some reason, FS17, especially when you're trying to record it, it behaves a lot differently to any other game I've encountered, and you get some really weird colours coming up. So you've got to do it a little bit differently, and you've got to adjust colours differently in order to get a good recording. Or at least I do with my software. I haven't had this issue before. I didn't have it with FS15, just with this one. So I've tried to reset all of my profiles for my colour settings, but I may not have got it entirely accurate, so I'm hoping that I've got it right, but because I'm pressed for time, I haven't really been able to check anything. That one's parked there because I'm going to run it back to the dealership shortly. The blade on the front is actually bought, not hired. I don't remember why we did that. I think it was because it wouldn't lease or something. Ooh, I actually need to have all of my flashes and my beacons and everything on for this. I'm not quite sure what was going on with that, but anyway, I've got to take that one back and sell it. And then we need to get the Tatra over to the dealership as well so that we can buy, lease our Scorpion And I will ask you the new weekly question. It's actually concerning what we're going to be doing in the next couple of weeks. So I'm hoping that you'll like it. And I'm also hoping that you'll sort of go with it. We'll see. Anyway, I will see you in a minute. I'm going to take this one up. And I have decided I'm going to do oilseed radish on field one. It'll stagger the harvest a bit and it'll make it a bit easier for us. Because we may be glad of some straw fairly early on. But we don't want to do an entire harvest all at once. So I'll get oilseed radish planted up there. So I'll get that started. And then I will see you over at the dealership, I think, with the Tatra. Okay, I have the Valtra is there with the front blade of the rower system, and we shall sell that one in just a moment. If I just unhitch this one and slide forward like that. So what we want to do is we want to lease the Scorpion, but we're at minus $40,000 at the moment, which is not very sort of useful. So let's just sell that one for $5,646. We are planting oilseed radish. You can see with the... I quite like this glance mod. It's very unobtrusive. It's very small up in the corner there. It's quite handy. It shows the two Lely Junos that we got, and we've got the Challenger. That one's working as well. Plus, we've got the engine is on over there, and I like that. It gives you a little tiny warning. So I think I prefer this glance mod to the inspector mod that we used to use in FS15, because it's less obtrusive, it takes up less of the screen, and it's nice being tucked away up in the corner up there. So this is the stuff that we own, and is there anything that we want to sell on here particularly? I don't think there is. I think we've sold everything we want to sell on there now. Anyway, let's go back. Forestry equipment. So we're going to need for the Ponsse Scorpion $25,000, which means we are going to need... Oh, my weekly question... Now, this is another placeable that I'm asking you about, and I don't actually have it installed yet. I will have it installed for tomorrow's episode so you can take a look at it. And basically, it's the sawmill mod by Mahu and Klein something, I can't remember his name now. Basically, it's a big sawmill. You've got to add fuel, and you've got to add... fuel is straw or wool pallets or wood chips, I think. And then you add logs, I think it is. And it saws them up and gives you pallets of sawn lumber. So you can then take those pallets of sawn lumber and you can sell them anywhere that you can sell wood chips. I don't know how much it's worth it, whether it is worth it or not. And there's also another mod you can use in conjunction with that. That is the beekeeping mod. Now, I kind of used one very similar to that in FS15 in the Higher Hill series. I might sort of throw that one in as well and we could just take a look at it, but I won't be doing a lot to that one because we did see it before and a lot of people said it's once you've done like an episode on looking at it, it kind of gets a bit dull, and I agree with you there. So I won't be doing more than about an episode if we get the bee pack, but that's another story. It's the sawmill at the moment. Do you want me to get the placeable sawmill mod? I'm not sure where I'll put it. Maybe I'd even put it back at our main yard. I don't know yet. We'll have to wait and see. First of all, we'll see if you want it. So yes or no, head in the comment section down below. Let us know if you want it. If you do, then obviously vote yes up in the top right hand corner. If you don't, vote no up in the top right hand corner. It's your vote. It's your game. Now, I need 560 for the barn. It's still going up. That is an absolute fortune. We could get very rich. At $560, it's just gone up then. We could get very wealthy doing that. Right, I'm going to borrow everything all the way up to $300,000, so it gives us a bit of money. That gives us $65,000. We will pay some of that back, I think, when we sell some silage. But right now, we want to go in here, there we go. And we want to go forestry equipment, and we want to go Scorpion King. Wheels, we can either have the tracks, or we can just have standard wheels. It's an extra... I don't think it's worth the extra money for leasing it, so we'll lease it with this. $25,000. Thank you very much. And if we go back, we're also going to get... We're not going to get it yet. We're going to get that one there. Where's the other one? There should be another one. I should have... Oh, I know where it is. We've got this one here, which we can get, which is the auto-load trailer. But if you go back out, it's in here, in Lambo mods... Cryptek Lambo, they've reskinned it and they've added a hitch on the back. One thing that I don't think was very good, and that is the reason that I've included this, and I did mention this before and I was asking you about this if you wanted me to use it. They have taken the mod from here, they've taken that mod and they've reskinned it and they've added the hitch on the back, but they haven't mentioned this modding team anywhere. They've also used Mahu's script, and that doesn't show up in the credits at all either. I'm a bit disappointed about that. I feel it could have been done a little bit better, but it does have the rear hitch on it, and I do like the texture on it. So we will probably be using that one. We use two of them together so that we got the rear hitch. But anyway, that's neither here nor there. We won't be doing that today. We probably won't even be doing that tomorrow. We want this bad boy here. Look at that. A scorpion. Scorpion King, no less. Not even just a scorpion. This is a king among scorpions. King, actually, yes. Yeah, so right there, it says King Scorpion rather than Scorpion King. This is a beast of a machine. Absolute beast of a machine. I've used this one quite a bit now in the time-lapse series, and I love it. I don't like cutting down trees with a chainsaw and then cleaning them. Using this one, it is absolutely fantastic. Absolutely brilliant. I love it. I absolutely despise picking stuff up after you've used it. It's one thing with this Gold Hofer trailer, is it really doesn't like that, does it? It does clip really badly right on that trailer bit, but there ain't a lot that we can do about that. So let's stop that one right there, and hopefully I'll be able to hitch up with that one where he is. Let's just jump out. You going to stay there? I hope so. We're going to take this one up and we're going to deliver it, and today we're going to be doing a little bit of tree slicing and dicing, where we're going to go. That's what we're going to be mostly about for the rest of today. Do I need to come forward? Do I need to go back? Oh, we've quite not got enough room. Where am I going? Over here. Let's jump in here. I'm just going to have to inch this one back this way, just a tiny, tiny smidgen, which means that we are going to have to clip those wheels slightly. Stop there. I really don't like doing that clipping bit. It doesn't look right. Let's come back a bit. There we go. Now I can hitch on. And apparently I don't... Okay, so we don't have enough room there to do that properly. So what I'm going to have to do is just extend the bed out slightly. Now, the thing with extending the bed is that it does slide underneath. I know that's not very realistic, but that is just the way that the game is made. Unfortunately, we can't do anything about that. You can't secure the machines down. I thought it would have been better if you could have strapped them on, but you can't. So we'll just have to do it like this. We just put on flashing beacons. Don't think that even in the States, I don't think you need to have the hazard lights going. I don't think you need to have them going while just on a truck with a trailer, a lorry with a trailer like this. It is a big load, so we're going to have our flashing beacon on, but other than that, I think we're okay. So I need to set our cruise control speed to 27, I do it to, because I've been told I was doing it at 25, and a lot of people were saying, look, you can go a little bit over the speed limit and you'll be fine. They allow it to slide. And I know that here in the UK, if you're driving along, they normally allow you 10% plus 2. Now, we don't have 25 mile an hour speed limits anywhere in the country. We've got standard speed limits right across the country. 30 miles an hour in a built-up area. 60 miles an hour on any smaller road. Any non-trunk road, I think it is. But, well, basically, you've got 30 miles an hour in a built-up area. Occasionally, you will have it signposted for a different speed limit, in which case you'll know what speed limit is because you will have 40 mile an hour or 50 mile an hour signposts up periodically, so you can sort of see what you, how much it is, how fast you're going. Motorways, which I guess is what you guys would call your interstate, your freeways, I guess, and you're like your highways, your freeways. So you got a motorway, which I think is like a freeway, and then you've got a dual carriageway, which is a two-lane road, which is maybe that's your highway. I don't know if highways and freeways are different in the States. I think I'm getting this right. I think a highway is equivalent to roughly our dual carriageway. It's two lanes in each direction, and then a freeway for us is the motorway, and that's three, very occasionally four lanes in each direction. Plus you've got like an emergency lane on the side where emergency vehicles can travel down if they need to, and also if you break down, you move on to this, it's called the hard shoulder, we call it, and it's like your emergency lane. So it's 70 miles an hour on the dual carriageways and motorways, 30 miles an hour in a built-up area, and it's 60 miles an hour across the board anywhere else in the country unless there is a signpost to say so. And it's that simple. So the 20... Basically, I've just sort of forgot where I started on this, but it's the 25, it's 10% plus 2. So in a 30 mile an hour zone, you could probably, now it's not to say always, but you could most likely get away with driving at 35 miles an hour, which is 10% plus 2. Although they do tend to be a bit stricter on the 30 mile an hour zone. If it's 30 miles an hour, you'll find 30 miles an hour. 40 miles an hour, you get away with 46, so 10% plus 2. And on a dual carriageway or a motorway, generally you could get away with just under 80 miles an hour, and the police will let that slide, unless it's a speed camera. If it's a speed activated camera and you get flashed, too bad, you've got to pay your, when the ticket turns up in the post, you've got to pay your fine. Right, let me just unhitch that one there, and I'll move the Tatra around, and we'll just park it up right here. We're going to stop there, I think. That's how our speed limits work. It's not to say that you can always get away with it, but I was told that in the States, you know, the 25 miles an hour, I could go 2 or 3 miles an hour over that limit, and it would probably be okay. So I've, as a general rule, I now drive at 27 miles an hour through the town. But elsewhere, I know that there are speed limits elsewhere on this map. However, I choose to ignore those, and I choose to just imagine that it's like 60 or 70 miles an hour on the other roads on the map, just, you know, for simplicity's sake, and to speed things up a little bit. So what I thought we would do in here is just to make it as interesting as possible. I'm not going to just do the trees right near the entrance to this bit of forestry. We're going to drive all the way up through here. I didn't think that we would try and take the transporter up through here because, yeah, it wouldn't happen. That's just a no-go all the way through here. So we will go all the way up here. We're going to go right up to the end, onto the little roundabout bit up the other end, and we're going to slice down a few trees up there. So we'll come up round this way. It's quite windy up through here. I've not done, other than like a quick run through and occasionally I spend the night here in the time lapse, I've not done anything in this area of forestry. There's a couple of areas of forestry I've not touched, not looked at, not done anything to them yet. Now I'm thinking, I know that this is a picnic area and technically it's open for the public, but this might be a good place to stick our placeable down here. I think it might. So yeah, what if we're going to put the placeable over there, be better, I think, if we start slicing trees over here, because I want to have some trees near the placeable for doing things with later on. So if we press F1, first of all, what we want to do is, I use the mouse for all of the controls on this one. I don't use the joysticks on this one. I got my joystick set for other ones, but see, I've just wiggled the joystick, nothing happens on here. If you have two joysticks set up, you can program them to go onto this one. I haven't done that. I don't have two joysticks. I've got no plans of getting any at the moment, because I actually find on this one the mouse is quite sufficient. I get on quite well with it. So what we want to do is turn the harvester on, and then our cut length at the moment is 1 meter, so I want to change that. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. 8 is the highest you go. Go again, you go down to 1. You do get mods that will chop trees longer than that, but at the moment we're going to stick with 8 meters. So let's just leave it like that. We've got an air horn on this thing. That is a monster horn for this vehicle. That's fantastic. Right, so let's get cutting. What we're going to do is we're going to cut a whole load of trees. I'm just wondering where we're going to put the branches. The logs. Oh no! I'm supposed to have the sawdust mod activated. I told you I'd have the sawdust mod. Okay, so we're not doing that today. I am actually nearly out of time, so we're going to be doing a bit more tree cutting tomorrow. I'll get the sawdust mod activated for tomorrow, because I told you I would do that, and I've been actually looking forward to trying that out, because I've seen it, and I thought, yeah, that'd be a really cool mod to use. Let me just move that out. There we go. So you just got to get the base of it around the tree, slice, and let it topple over however it wants to. Now I'm going to bring that one over here, and you can move around, you can drag the trees around quite a long way with these. Fantastic. So let's just slice that one right there, and it'll do, drops it down there. So yeah, we don't have the sawdust thing going. That's a bit of a shame. I will make sure I've got that installed ready for our next episode, because I think that would be absolutely fantastic. we get that. Now, I did notice that when I did the... I planted all those trees in the time-lapse, and then I've been cutting them. They're all exactly the same length. All the trees have grown to exactly the same length. My timer has just gone off to say that we've run out of time. So, I planted all those trees. They're all the same length. You get exactly 4 logs out of every single tree, which is great. It's a fantastic amount of wood to be getting from each tree. So now we're going to the ones that are like on the default map, which is a lot different because some of them, like that one, you get your 4 lengths out of, and some of them you don't. I mean, this one you even get 5 lengths. This is a much longer tree. Where you get, it's like 4.5 lengths. And then some of them are much shorter, and I do find it's sometimes quite difficult to get hold of the shorter trees. And let's just bring that one, I want to extend that out a bit. It's also difficult to judge because, like I've said before, you're trying to do 3D stuff in a 2D environment. It's a flat screen. And so you don't have depth perception. It is quite difficult to judge your depth in 2D when you're like looking at it, which is why I don't like generally doing stuff inside the cab because you just can't judge the distances. And let's bring that one up there. Big-ish tree we got there. Several logs. We'll, for our first few branches, what I think we'll do is we'll sell some branches here. So we're not going to be pressed for having to get silage. We could go and get the auto-load timber runner. We could bring that one up and load up 2 trailer loads of timber, take that up to the sawmill, sell those up there, and then come back again and maybe get another couple of loads of wood and take those to the train, load them at the train, so that we can have a go with the crane, and then we can have a look at the placeable after that. We should have got enough money. At least that's what I'm hoping. So we'll be cutting down a whole load of trees, and you've got all sorts of rough terrain here, so let's bring that out. Helper D, that would be our... just bring that one up like that, and down. I can almost reach that tree. Bring it round this way. It's so much more difficult when you've got the rough terrain that you're using to get this stuff. When I was doing those trees in the field in the time lapse, it's much, much easier. You don't have to worry about judging the distances of anything. You just like slide forward a tiny little bit and everything is all lined up beautifully. It's perfect. You couldn't hope to have it better, basically. Should be about right. Sometimes you can sort of bring it close to it and then you press the cup like that there. You press the cut button and it sort of just drags it to it, which is good. It means that the game is a little bit forgiving if you don't get things absolutely perfect. It does help a great deal. So my question for this week is, would you like me to get and install the sawmill by Mahu and Klein something, I think. I'm not entirely sure of his name. I will try to find that out. Actually, I'll get the sawmill mod installed so that I can show you in the placeable section what it is for tomorrow's episode. I'm also going to get the sawdust stuff. But yeah, if you would like me to use the sawmill at a later date, next week sometime, because I'm hoping that we'll do 2 weeks of forestry stuff. We might sort of break it up with some harvest next week so that we can get some straw if you want the sawmill mod. We'd need to get straw to be able to power it, or we could maybe even shred some trees to get some wood chips. Although you did say you didn't really want wood chips. Actually, no, you said you didn't want the wood chip heating plant. So maybe we could do a few wood chips and we could use those to power the sawmill. I'm not sure yet. But anyway, if you want the sawmill, head in the comment section down below. Let us know that you do. And if you don't, then likewise, head in the comment section. Let us know that you don't. Please give us some reasons if you've... you know, as to why you do and you don't want it. Don't forget to actually cast your vote in the top right hand corner. It's your vote, it's your game, you decide how we do things around here. But in particular, I would really like to know your reasons for wanting or not wanting the sawmill, and if you do want it, what would you like me to do with it? Because several of you will have already seen the sawmill. I know this because several of you have been asking me to get the sawmill, which is why I'm asking you the question this week. And I think it could be sort of quite an interesting experience to use the thing. Right, let's just bring this one around. I'll get that tree there. And lower down. Right, I need to spin the clamp round like that. And then let's just bring it back a little bit. There, that's perfect. Ish, he says. There we go. Yes, we got that one. I can back up. Now, oop, I want to back the right way. bring it over there. The trees do sort of bounce around a bit sometimes, but generally speaking, it's not too bad. So we've got quite a lot of logs here. That should be easily a full trailer, and then maybe a bit more besides, but we'll do a little bit more cutting at the beginning of the next episode before we go and get a trailer. And then we will get a trailer, we'll lease one, and see about selling some of these branches. We've got loads of them here now. It might be an idea, actually, if we get the lease the trailer at the beginning of the next episode, just so that we got it there available, just in case that we lose a load of money for whatever reason, because that does seem to happen on a fairly regular basis. We think we're doing okay, and then suddenly we have a bill come through for a load of our leasing equipment, and we lose all of our money. So, yeah, maybe we'll play it safe. We'll see. So if you've enjoyed this episode, then please head down below and give us a like. And if you really enjoyed it, then please tell your friends all about me. Get them to watch as well. That would be awesome. But until next time, thank you very much for watching. This is Frithgar. Goodbye, and see you later.